sort of beyond the issue. I was building an application, and I thought at some point that it's some of those applications become so big they kind of move around. So this is me. I have a bunch of things that I write, a bunch of applications that I work on different things. So if you're not on a date though, so I'm gonna talk about myself. If you're interested about me, you can probably find me on Twitter or Google my name. I was not part of the iCloud week thing in this part. Let's do that in the way. So what are we talking about? What is beyond PHP? So sometimes you read these claims on the internet. Twitter recently, or a couple years ago, went using Scala. And you think, oh, this is great. We've been using PHP for a while, maybe we should use a different technology. Maybe we should pick up a fancier language. Let's write our application in something better. Now, what are we trying to do? Who tried to rewrite their application in a different language? How did that work?
Server and the Lord of the Rings, and everything's not blocking, everything's amazing. But none of that's true.
But it's a pretty good language because there's an interesting concept of non-blocking IOPS. So if you need to request a bunch of different things from a database, you can request 5 of them or 10 of them at the same time, and then they finish, you can continue. As opposed to PHP, you request one thing, you're waiting to finish, you request another thing, you're waiting to finish, and you just keep doing it and keep waiting. So non-blocking languages are really cool. How do you get it to PHP? That's a problem. Because PHP is a sequential language, where everything runs in a sequence, and it's very hard to do threading language. If you're doing web applications and you try to fork PHP, it's impossible. Anyone have tried to fork PHP? Yeah, in Europe, yes. I'm sorry. There is a better solution. It's called React PHP. It's pretty much Node.js or PHP minus all the bullshit. It's kind of very slow. There's a Linux library or a C library called libevent, which works on the basis of events. So there's a main thread running, and as you issue events, as the IO is coming in, it is able to run some code. So it has been integrated into a PHP extension, and then this framework was written, which allows you to write pretty much Node.js-like applications where you request things and then you have promises and you wait for something to happen. But it's still PHP. So if you're interested in doing I/O, or if you're doing a lot of I/O and you need something better, React PHP is really good. I've used it before and it works really well. Actually, that's not really what I want to talk about. What I want to talk about is code in most of the cases, with a single application, your index.php file or your framework, is probably not a problem. Performance problems are very easy to fix, I think, and especially if you have managed by servers. So you just keep buying servers, and the performance of the language somehow disappears. Like, people are running COBO in like IBM mainframes, and all the language is probably one of the slowest around. That's not how people score. So I guess you can just program. Also, you can like, run Hello World benchmarks, and you might be looking at Node.js and JavaScript is running some path because it's V8 and C code and blah blah blah. And it's not actually that fast because it's just running a Hello World benchmark. And actually, really well, which makes HP web scale way more than Node.js, this is one. And it's using labels, so it's way better. Node.js doesn't have labels, it's better. And these are sort of benchmarks you can run. To prove it, which is kind of fast enough that you can be running. But all this is fucking nonsense because doesn't like the language itself and the performance of the language doesn't really matter that much. Because all these problems are easily fixable and the language itself doesn't really change anything. So I guess one of the main points is that if you want to move beyond PHP, you have to think about programming concepts and architectures and applications beyond the language itself, beyond the PHP code itself. Because what PHP code is, it's just a syntax, it's just a language. Same way you move from Polish to English, you can move from PHP to another language, in theory, and be able to implement the same sort of things. So, the reason why it's not easy is because you usually have monolithic applications. So say you build a simple application, just one big thing, and one day you're like, oh, maybe I should just introduce, a Python script somewhere, but your application is already in PHP, it's already one big simple application. How do you do it? It's pretty difficult. So what you want to do is move away from it, not other applications. You want to move away from having single big units of code to have a layer or a network of different applications, a distributed system where you can replace different parts with different languages. And thus go beyond. It's all about extendability. It's how do you create systems which are extendable beyond the initial idea? Because that's what people usually have is that they start an application and they don't realize it's a bad application that's been being developed for 5 years. And 5 years from now, none of that code is probably good enough anymore. You all moved on to different frameworks. Every language versions and new features available, but your code is not all staged. So how do you deal with long-term projects and still be able to use all the new core functionality? My biggest actual problem with a lot of the PHP frameworks, especially SIM42, for example, is that they get all really good. It's like an Android phone that just gets released and a month later no one supports it anymore. So you can't get the latest software. You can download an iPhone user. was like the one application I'm running, it was Symfony 2, like a preview version of a beta. And Symfony 2.0 came out, and we spent like a month trying to upgrade different parts of it. Took forever. And 2.1 came out, and we were like, oh, we just changed the performance library, it's better now, and by the way, another issue. It's terrible, and it, like, so if, as the frameworks are getting older, your old code doesn't work at all. On the Zen Framework 1 applications. And Zen Framework 1 is not being developed or supported anymore. So how do you make use of all the cool stuff? And the way to do that, and the first step to kind of language-dependent code, is you have to write applications not to work on a specific framework, but work as a separate coding. Pretty much every modern PHP framework supports services as controllers. Your service just has a bunch of functions, and your controller or front controller is just calling that, and it gets a piece of your code as well. So the first step is to do platform-dependent code, or language-dependent code, and kind of moving away from a single thing is to split your code from a framework. Your library, your application should be its own thing, the framework should be its own. And if you have that set up, then you can always be upgrading the framework with every new feature, with every new release, and most of the stuff will work. So you want to move most of your business logic to framework independent code and just leave a thin layer of framework independent code. That way, new features don't really break. But yet, you might be running. I've heard that Python is really fast. I've heard that Python has a lot of cool features, and I would like to write a given worker in Python. Or you've heard that, for example, in Java has a bunch of cool data libraries, so maybe I would like to somehow integrate them into my PHP language. So you know your code is plenty of code. Your application is almost independent from frameworks. You still can translate PHP straight to, for example, Python. You can try it, but it's syntax is being filled into different issues. You can just copy and paste to different languages. So, I mean, the problem you're kind of facing is you can kind of almost take your code and just translate that to Python, or just translate a few libraries. But this is just going to take too much time, and then you're going to have your whole future application written in PHP and just a few little blobs of Python. It just becomes unmanageable and it's hard to do. So the way to do it right is to build service oriented. Actually, George and I will talk about this later this afternoon. And what service oriented applications mean is that instead of having a single massive application, which I was kind of talking about before, instead of building a network or a mesh of applications, where every single one of them is taking care of a different thing, because then you can have a Python API which does some kind of data processing. You can have a PHP web application or a Java backend which does search, and they're all three separate units. You can have three separate teams working on them and be able to use different languages. Even though the application itself, the unit itself, is just one big mesh. The problem with that, how you actually do right, is that it's all it becomes a distributed system. So instead of having your whole code, your whole library, your whole application in one folder, now it's split into different systems almost. And so testing becomes really complicated because you're no longer able to run unit tests. Because the app doesn't live in one code base, your PHP unit won't be able to test Python scripts. And also, the communication between components becomes more difficult because you cannot just have a Python service in code level and call some PHP script from it. The only way to do this is just run that exact command and just run it as a normal script, but then actually communicable. So you have to build in some kind of a communication. So the first step to start with is you build a slim front end first. So that's what PHP works the best. Works the best for is you build a slim front end which can be a simple application, a slim application, a Zen framework application, which all it does is handle those user requests. So as a user request comes in, maybe there's some filtering, and then dispatches an API call via Python script or a JavaScript or a PHP script, whatever you want. If the form gets submitted again, it does the form handling, the form filtering, and then dispatches the request to anywhere else. And as you do that, the PHP script just works as a kind of as a proxy. It works as a handler of requests, as opposed to being that itself. What that allows you to have is isolated systems. Because the PHP frontend does the frontend part. Then you have, for example, PHP API code, which handles data inserts. Then you can have PHP security layer, which handles the security system. Then you can have separate developers, separate frameworks, separate libraries being used for different parts. That first of all, that makes all the things quite easier because you can manage it separately, you can test it separately, you can deploy it separately. And also, because we are isolated systems, if one of them breaks, the whole application doesn't break. And the first step we usually do is we have a web frontend and we have a kind of a backend frontend which handles all the cron scripts, all the long-running tasks, and they're all separate in separate code bases and in separate servers. So if our backend crashes, the front end is still running. If a front end crashes or having some memory issues, the backend is still running. So they're both independent, they're working separately to work on different tasks. And the way you communicate that is, like I'm saying, like, so instead of just being like hello world service, call hello on it, and it returns some result, you can no longer do it because we're, again, as I mentioned, they're in separate code bases, they're in separate systems. So how do you do it? Well, of course, you can use a few systems to do that. Any of you have used Gearman? If not, if you haven't used Gearman, that's probably the easiest way to start with kind of asynchronous delayed operations in PHP. Gearman is a library which has a bunch of clients and a bunch of workers. And the client says, oh, we need this image resized. And the worker says, okay, I'm going to resize it for you, and it returns the result. But because we're running a separate script, they're all independent. So you can have 10 workers running and 1,000 clients running. And as your users have submitted images to resize, the queue is just filling up. But instead of killing your server, they're just all going to be processed with 10 workers. So your processing size is always fixed. It's only the queue which handles how many of them are going to get handled in the same time. You do the same thing as you build the distributed system. So instead of calling things directly, you just queue up operations. So if your user logs in, you queue up an operation saying check if the security matches. Then your security system picks it up from a queue and says, okay, this is the user, these are the params, check the database, or maybe some calling API. Do they match some kind of, for example, PHPVB installation? Yes, they match, return a result, your front end can proceed. Or if you don't like the kind of delayed and queued approach, then you can just add RESTful APIs. Again, you have separate systems, and you develop everything in the mind of RESTful APIs. Famously, Amazon did that for everything in Amazon.com. So when they launch their Amazon Cloud, their AWS, all these APIs were being used before for themselves. They were using it internally. But once they wanted to launch publicly, they just did a switch and everything went live. And the way they handled it, their CEO, Jeff Bezos, said, no one is allowed to call any internal methods. No one is allowed to talk to any databases directly. The only way you can get data, or the only way to get something executed somewhere else, is to call an API. And that changed the mentality, that changed the way people build up the data. Because they had to expose every single method as an API. And you do the same, and you can do the same thing as long as you expose things as API calls, then anyone can call. Doesn't matter what the language is, doesn't matter what the protocol is, it's all the same. And what that allows, having distributed systems, having systems which communicate using queues and RESTful APIs, what it allows is that any part of an application can be any language you want. And that's actually really powerful, because you can hire someone here and they're like, oh, I really like Node.js. And you have PHP code base and I think PHP is terrible. Someone needs JavaScript. And you can be like, sure. It's all a distributed system, so you can write your own components in your own language. And they're all going to be talking to guys anyway, so you never really care. Depending on your size, depending on project size, that actually might be fine. And if you're moving away, for example, from data processing just as a bunch of SQL queries to some really serious data processing in PHP and data processing in Python, you just start migrating scripts to Python applications. And eventually, that part of the application, the part which handles data processing, is now running in Python. It's really powerful. So how do you actually achieve that? Because the problem you're having, again, is you have this monolithic application. Everything is running in one code base. Everything is being handled by one single application. How do you split different functionalities into their own languages, or in their own libraries, or in their own APIs? Yes? We were just actually having a conversation with how do you handle migrating things, how do you handle refactoring, as with everything. You do step by step, so it's kind of split and compare approach. And how it works is you have a big application, you always have, you're running some kind of performance analysis, you're running some kind of metrics, so you know how things are running, how fast are they running. And so you're making new feature requests, you're thinking, should I add it to my existing code base, or should I split into a separate service, should I split into a separate system? And with that approach, you can just at some point, just slice off the little application, move it to its own repository, either leave it at PHP or convert it to a different language, and develop that separately. And eventually, just add the API, start communicating with all the application, and everything just moves on as if everything was working as before. And then, most importantly, nowadays it's very, very cheap to run virtual environments. Docker is probably the newest fastest growing one. Any of you have used Docker before? So a few people. Any of you are using VMs now? And so Docker, in a way, is kind of a replacement for VMs. You can think about it in that way. What Docker does is instead of having VMs for your server systems, instead of having VMs for your services, it runs everything in Linux. Which is kind of a feature of Linux kernel. It allows the Linux kernel to have self-contained isolated environments for different applications. So with Docker, you can deploy many applications to a single server. They can all be sharing resources, yet they're super isolated, so they can't cause each other any havoc. So you can have different PHP versions running the same server easily, you can have different languages running the same server easily. They're all isolated, secure, they can't hack each other, they can't cause CPU leaks and all the problems. What Docker gets to provide people is that now you can have 50 applications running on one server, 100 applications running on one server very easily. And if the server becomes just too small for to handle all that, you just take one of these Docker VMs and just put it in the server. Or just you just put one server into two of them and then just put the whole applications. It's a very, very powerful tool. It's great to use for service oriented architectures.
How does it differ from Docker?
So, let's talk about it. So, Docker doesn't run a VM. There's a thing called Linux container, which is Linux level isolation processes. So, it runs in its own, has its own memory. Some kernel resources, but it doesn't have the overhead of the VM. So everything still runs on your server, but everything still runs on the same kernel, as if you had just running as a PHP script on the same server, but it runs in isolation, so it doesn't have access to the server system. It's like a Linux, mini Linux operating system. What basically allows you to have is that it's very hard on your laptop to run 50 VMs. It's probably going to crash because it needs memory for every single VM. With Docker, you can run 50 separate VMs we're not actually creating new operating systems. We're just using the same operating system as a host. And then your Docker VM just has your host. Because there's no overhead on those running. Basically, it's a cheaper way to run VMs. It's a much faster way because you run the Docker script initially, but there's nothing to start. And operating system is already running. It does run on the Mac, so runs on Linux only. It's a Linux computer. But it allows you, for example, to use Heroku or your own platform as a service cheaper and very easy. Because it's pretty much a platform itself. You just have a Linux server, you have your kind of Docker definition panel, you deploy it, and then you just run through it. You just define what protocol it's really going to be running. You want to support it. So for PHP, that would be I'm going to run Apache, and it's going to support the port 80, and then your Docker VM is going to support port 80. And you just cross the and you have access to your RPG scripts. Very powerful tool. Most importantly, it's a cheaper and more efficient way to run multiple applications on a single server.
That's really good.
Yeah. And you can also run it with Vagrant too. So, if, for example, if I have a Mac, it's running Mac OS, so I can rerun a Docker natively, but I can have a Vagrant version of Linux VM, which runs all the Docker. If they can stop numbers from the it's being called as like the most important thing of virtualization. Because it's a step away from virtualization. Because the problem with VMs is they have a lot of overhead, especially in IO. Because for this request, it needs to tell everything from code there, With Docker, everything runs here. I don't have a full panel of the full views, but it handles the isolation. That's a feature of the Linux kernel. So that person can just wrap her from the provide APIs and tooling. And for example, there is quite a famous hosting client now called DigitalOcean.com. And they started off by just saying, drop all these Docker containers and you can run them for client customer with plenty of resources. We've been using it for a while, just kind of testing purposes, and it's way better than using it. Just as it allows the user to use it. Most importantly, it allows you to run many different applications in one server without wasting resources. So, what I'm saying is okay, so we kind of figured out some ways to do to split applications to run different languages to run different processes. How do you actually figure out why would I move to different languages? How do you figure out which language to pick and even consider this? So, the thing I recommend first, and at least that's what I do a lot, is don't try to run any data processing in PHP. The problem with data is that you usually have a lot of it, and PHP is just terrible at handling memory. So, even the smallest integer, it's going to take at least 150 bytes, as opposed to one. And so if you have an array of million numbers, it's going to take hundreds of megabytes of memory. So eventually you're just going to run out of memory and it's not going to work. So the first thing I split up on an application is data processing. Like we use Python a lot for all the data handling. Probably has the most libraries, the most tooling. For any sort of data slicing and calculating statistical probabilities and all these different tasks, Python is probably your best bet. And very easily integrates with the Python language itself because all these models are needed. That's the first thing is the data processing off to Python. Or before you do that, don't run anything as a user clicks the button to your website, run everything with workers in the background with your group. Another thing is how you handle the read now. Everyone's trying to build either some chat system or an API for a mobile browser. The problem with all these is that they kind of want real time. So as a user is pushing the application, your application should be changing. If a user has a chat open, everything has to be changing. So how do you do that? For a while, everyone did mobile pulley where you would calling a server every 5 seconds, and if there's a new data, you just keep data in a server, you want to push that out to the client, you can use socket.js, which is the, not socket.js, but you can use web sockets on the client. The problem is, HTTP is pretty bad at handling long running scripts. So if you have a web socket connecting to a HTTP backend, if you have 1,000 users connecting to 1,000 HTTP requests on the server, and they're all just sitting and waiting for the data to come in, it's probably going to close the server pretty quick. So, how do you do? That's what Node.js was created for. Is to handle sockets really well. If you want to do real time applications, then you can use, use React HTTP. Because that handles sockets really well. And you can have all the clients connecting to a single HTTP script or single application that front end. And efficiently, in fact, the task handles all. Well, it depends on the server, depends on the applications, but it doesn't block. I've tried it locally and like just for testing purposes, and it, because it doesn't pull the request, it doesn't need them to go.
First of all, crowd, the delete memory was using.
we just kind of, as a testing thing, we just wrote a tinier script in Python, and it was much faster. So now we're like, okay, maybe we should just migrate that whole application, the whole kind of scraping infrastructure to Python. But then you're like, kind of stuck because you have this monolithic function. Where we just started with a more separate application, more separate units, we'd be able to migrate them. So, to finish, young PHP needs think about distributed systems, think about network implementations, and that will allow you to use any language you want in a project you want, because there's not a single application. With that, does anyone have any questions? Apart from that, we're going to talk about it. Does anyone have any questions? Okay, there's a question there.
Sort of documentation that says, okay, in order to run that project locally, you need to set up this endpoint, and different technology stacks. And, wasn't that a hassle, like, for newcomers?
No, really. So, for example, the way we do it, have you used Payment before?
No.
You should probably check it out. What Payment allows you to do is, so now the code repository, for the main code repository, they have a Payment file that defines. For example, saying there are 5 VMs, and for all these people.
Okay, is it, did you say Vagrant?
What's that?
Did you say Vagrant or Python in New York?
Vagrant.
I use Vagrant, yeah.
So that's Vagrant. If you use Vagrant, then you just say these are file applications, these are the public scripts, you set them up. As a new developer joins the team, you just press Vagrant up, and the whole stack just fills.
Okay, so you set up every endpoint, every API in public, or shell.
So we have close to production, pretty much like a mirror of production locally on your
sounds cool.
Yeah. So because that's the kind of power of the agent is I can set up 5 VMs, I can run like 2 servers, kill one of them and see what happens to the whole thing. Because everything's scripted, even the new developer of drones doesn't really need to know all the intricacies of different things, the whole thing is built. So. And because we use things like composer to define
there's really no setup for a single person. All things are already predefined.
So you said about
giving everything is private, and if you like to write in a different language, you could do it. It sounds like a mess. I mean, how many developers you have to hire if you got 5 modules and every one of them is written in different type?
Yeah, so maybe it depends on project size or the whole project. So if you work on a bigger project, sometimes it's just worth it to have two languages to include. Because you have reasonable JavaScript, you don't have to figure out how to debug the language really quickly. Of course, if you have like, 2 developers in the team, don't just go out and building everything in a different language because that's just going to work. But if you have bigger teams and bigger projects, if you're running some kind of a business tool or a project, an enterprise tool, which is a huge application, then you know firsthand that you're just going to have more people to back up the development process. And I've never seen a problem with 5 languages because no one actually picks up. Usually I have like 2 languages or 3 languages. So you just can't handle it. But most of the way, I think most of the developers would be these languages. Only all of you can write JavaScript, all of you can write PHP. Probably most of you can write Python. So it's easy for developers to pick up the languages. I find it easy.
Yeah. So you mentioned about German, and I have a question for you. Do you know any other system? With a German, there's no possibility to point that some action has to be done after some action.
Yeah. So, for example, we use Celery, which is C, E, L, E, it allows you to define sequences of tasks, it allows you to define groups of tasks, which all have to run or like none of them will run, or all of them have to run in the sequence or none of them will run. It allows you to define very complicated things. And you can, I'm pretty sure there's a way to call it completion, because all of this is just force messages. If you want to implement something yourself, look into your own computer. Because that allows you to find very complicated topologies like queuing systems or queuing systems.
Okay, first thing, certainly improving which can help you in the pool. And about the disturbed systems, it's a little tricky because it's very easy to get trouble if you start complicating servers. Services. It's very easy to get messy. And there's a lot of problems with finding bottlenecks in all systems. And can you tell me how you resolve the issue with developers? Yeah, because you cannot take true developers from your city and put this application and say, just write any feature. Yeah, because
first of all, how do you find bottlenecks and how do you find performance issues? You measure a single application with metrics, so there's going to be a talk later with Ash on software metrics and logging. You do a single sort of approach to every single application, so like every single path code is measured by something, so performance issues are going to be handled. Finding developers, I guess it's a problem in every country and every environment. Hiring remote teams, reaching out beyond your city helps you find quality talent. But I agree with you. If you just get someone straight out of the school, they don't really have the experience to do things. So, of course, if the guy comes from the university and they're like, oh, Java's a bad thing, they'll just go write Java code because the next thing you know, you're better.
I wish I was rich enough to run more. But if you
hire remote teams, it allows you to have quality talent. I know, for example, everyone in the UK has a development group. Because no one in the UK is a good looking. Because no one is in the UK from years. We hear no one's going to be the show. But everyone in the UK hires a development group because it's
do you have to in some way say stop doing that? We have to make this easier, reduce on services because tolerance is complicated.
Yeah, so we make every time we develop anything, we do everything pull requests. And the way I imagine is like I monitor the pull request time. So we can take a pinpoint to let it being submitted as a pull request or how long it took. And based on that, we measure the kind of the problems of the system. It's all it says, they always add this function, this form into a website, and it took you 2 days to add it. Either you're in it, or the system is just too complicated, things are just too hard to change. And then you go out and look at this, should we refactor this, or should we remove this from scratch? But because you know how much every single all I ask you is to add a form, and the pull request is 1,000 final change. And there's always a problem in the system. Everything is just to add a couple of everything is just under everything you can imagine. It's all about being aware of change, being aware of what's happening. Yeah, but pull request, of course, can't solve it because you do peer reviews and you see everything works.
And I have a question. How do you handle with integration testing through web services?
So, this guy's in the corner pretending to listen. He's focused. It's fine. He has a public 3PM which talks about the service-oriented architecture and testing with integration. So, usually the way to do it is. It's not a problem, you know. But the way to do it is you test everything locally with the real tests. then you run full-on system stacks in the region. You can run things now like modularly in parallel, so like the way we've done it before, you just spin up a new VM or a new Docker instance for the test, you set up the whole system, you run everything, so you can use databases, and that's just like APIs, everything, and then you just check the results. If your application is API-based, so it's much easier than if your application is just a web front-end, because then you actually use that sled, you know, something that's heavier, it's all like a bit more numbers, so it's harder to test in the back. But yeah, continuous integration systems, which in every commit or in every pull request in every branch, that's everything automatic.
When you talked about monolithic application, you gave a simple as an example. I mean, why do you say that about framework that is set upon loose-coupled components and encourages its developers to create applications that are loose-coupled?
Yeah, I didn't mean it as a simple example, but I think simple is great. But for example, someone just did this e-commerce system on Symfony. They built up trying to split in and just a different application. Even the most basic, Symfony has to be really still depend on Symfony being there. So you can't split it. Like the way we did, like if I had some kind of validation for an order system, I want it to be my own account, not dependent on Symfony. Because it depends on Symfony. We've only ever set up framework one for all the pages. People like the framework because everything will depend on the framework one. So that's the issue, it's migration and upgradability. And because it provides every framework provides all the ease of use tools, easily it depends on the framework. A lot of developers, a lot of teams, so people start using them, and then next thing you know, you depend on them. It's more about the mentality and how you use the framework. Because you could use it simply independently as an independent framework and don't actually rely on most people. So if anyone knows to talk about distributed systems more, we should do just before I leave the line, I should do one thing quickly. So I'm going to share my slides online. The one thing you want to find in the slides, there's a link on the 24th slide. It's called microservices, 72 resources. So this guy wrote a blog post, and then he's 72 articles about building distributed systems and service-oriented architectures. He's really good. If you actually search for microservices resources, talks about all the things I've talked about in way greater detail and then like expansive different topics. Accessibility is being one of them, deployment is being one of them. And the scaling teams is being done. So it's really worth it. And again, if you have any more.